Alright, hello everybody, this is Piteo from the 9th Age Forum, and in this video I wanted to show you a game of the quick starter of the 9th Age using the pre-made army lists, and these are going to be the lists for the Undying Dynasties on one side and Sylvan Elves on the opposite side. Now, let's be polite and do introductions first. Let's have a quick look at the army lists. Sorry. So here we have the Undying Dynasties. Okay? We have the who will be playing the game on Universal Battle. So here is the ensemble force for this faction. And you can see that we have 15 Necropolis Guards and 3 Shaptis. And these are both combat units, I would say. And both have the Undead special rule, which is this token here, and in which you see the effect of this specific rule. I mean, undead armies have no undead soldiers have no individual will, so they don't behave like the rest of the normal soldiers in the Ninth Age Wards. And so, for example, they cannot decide to flee from a charge. They pass automatically the panic and the break tests, but they lose wounds whenever they fail a break test. And also, this is important, they cannot march unless they are close enough to the general. All right. Then we also have skeleton archers, and so as the name says, they are armed with bows, and this is the specific type of bow that they have. It's an interesting one because it ignores all two-hit modifiers. I mean, the skeletons are not aiming at the target. The arrows are guided by the will of the sorcerer who evoked them. And let's talk about this guy. Let's talk about the hierarch. You can see here that he has quite a number of special rules here. Like, for example, general. We said that undead need a general just even to march. And also has 3 spells. The Danse Macabre, that allows a unit to move forward. Death is only the beginning, which resurrects re-dead undead models. And Fate's Judgment, which is a missile, and which does damage. Let's then now have a look at the other faction, which the Sylvan Elves, and let's start with a look at the iconic unit for this book, which is the Sylvan Archers. You see that they have a Sylvan Longbow, which hits on a 3+, and this is a very good bow. It has armor penetration 1 and ignores the modifiers for moving and shooting. This is a nice weapon. This is a nice weapon. We also have Wild Huntsmen, which are cavalry, shock cavalry, and they have this devastating charge special rule, which means that they get an extra bonus when they charge the opponent. They're not made to be charged. And we also have the dryads, 8 dryads, and these have the special rule that gives them special protection, which you roll if you fail the armor save. And this extra protection, this Aegis protection, is not affected by armor penetration. And also here, sweet final item, the general, so the druid, also has the general and the longbow special rules, but importantly has 2 spells, and those are both, the 2 are spells that are cast on your own units to make them stronger. One is this truth of time that makes a unit faster, and the other one is healing waters, which grants this special save that we were just talking about 2 seconds ago, the Aegis save. Alright, so these are the 2 armies. Let's jump straight to the pre-game sequence, and in this phase of the game you prepare the battlefield. So we rolled for one of the random maps. I created 4 maps and I randomized, and on a roll we got this center hill. So we have a hill in the middle in difficult terrain, hindering terrain in the top right hand side of the screen, this sort of lake, and then clockwise you have an impassable terrain, this temple with a statue, and two torches, and then bottom left another hindering terrain, which is a forest, and then top left another impassable terrain, which is a building. And then we roll for who chooses the deployment zone and deploys first, and this happens to be the Sylvan Elves. So we have the archers with the druid north of the impassable temple. Then we have the dryads, and in front of the dryads, to the very bottom, the huntsmen, the wild huntsmen. So now the Undying Dynasties deploy. So you have the archers near the house, then the necropolis guards, and behind the forest you have the Shaptis. All right. So we are ready to start with number one. So Sylvan Elves deployed, and so they are going to have the first turn. Now, as you might know, turns are divided in phases. Phase number one is the charge phase. You can follow the counter in the top right to know in which phase we are. Sorry. And in this phase, nothing happens because you have to be a bit closer than this to be able to charge your opponent. So in the very first phase of the game, not much happens most of the times. In the movement phase, you can move your units forward, and that's what I did with the Sylvan Elves units here. So I can go back and forth between these two slides. It looks, yeah, very sad. Anyway, so you can move the units forward or backwards or sidewards or whichever way. So this is the movement starting to put some pressure and keep everything close together, nice and snug. In the magic phase, the first thing to do is to roll for the flux cards to know how strong the magic in the air is in this specific moment. And this card tells you that with this specific roll, the Sylvan Elves are going to have 4 magic dice and the Undying Dynasties are going to have 3. And even if there is an advantage, I try to cast Truth of Time, the speed augment spell, but it was dispelled with 3 dice by the Undying Dynasties. Shooting phase, well, there's going to be no shooting because my shooters are behind the hill, and so they can't really see anything. And the there is no combat phase either. So we can jump to turn number one for the Undying Dynasties. And here, nothing happens in the charge phase, because we're still relatively far away. But interestingly, in the movement phase, the Undying Dynasties player decides to go back a bit. I mean, they have strong shooting and they have strong magic, so it's understandable to, you know, not push the fight too soon. In the magic phase, Undying Dynasties roll the card number 4, and still, even with 6 dice, there are no viable spell targets, because it doesn't want to move the any unit with the Danse Macabre. Nobody needs to be raised because nobody has died on the battlefield. And what's the other one? The missile, but it's too far away in the hierarchy to have any target in range. So there's no magic in this phase. That happens. It's not a shock. The shooting phase, something does happen though. The archers, not all of them, because some of them are too far away, but a part of them can shoot at the dryads, and they manage to... Yeah, right? That's not nice when dryads die, but yeah, one does die. Nothing happens in the combat phase, and we move to turn 2 for the Sylvan Elves again. Now, charge phase from here, not really too far away. Nothing really happens, so we move to the movement phase. You can still track the change of the phases by using the counter to the top right of the screen. And in the movement phase, this is kind of interesting because archers are bold and go up the hill, and then the Wild Huntsmen do a very complex wheeling base type of movement that puts them nice and snug next to the archers, and then the Dryads complete the formation in a nice line, and that's the movement phase. Looking at the magic phase, Sylvan Elves got 8 dice, so you know that this is the phase when something big has to happen, and so I managed to cast the Truth of Time on the Wild Huntsman, which is great. And I try to cast the Healing Waters on the Sylvan Archers, but that's dispelled, which is really not great. But, you know, that's at least one good outcome. The more tactical one, the more movement-related one, rather than the strategy and the numbers-related spell. So, yeah, that's the magic phase. We move to the shooting phase, and the Archers of the Sylvan Elves shoots at the archers of the Undying Dynasties, and they put 2 to rest again. Nothing happens in the combat phase, and this means that we move to turn 2 of the Undying Dynasties. So what happens here? No charging, and actually in the movement phase some more retreating, which is, you know, kind of you know that to win a quick starter pre-made list game, you have to have the most units within six inches from the center of the battlefield. So if you're still retreating by turn 2, that's okay, because 3 and 4 you can charge and you can dash and you can advance, that's okay. But, you know, beyond that, it becomes a bit difficult. Anyway, movement phase, the 3 units, the archers to the top, the Necropolis guards to the in the middle, and the 3 Shaptis at the bottom, they both go behind a bit sideways in the case of the Shaptis. Magic phase, really nasty. I don't remember the details, but Fate's Judgment missile from the from the Hierarch on the Sylvan Archers, and 3 dies. Luckily, they do pass the panic test, because more than 25% died, but and in these cases you have to check whether the unit freaks out and decides to flee, but that wasn't the case. And then, same thing in the shooting phase. I think that there's a typo there. In the shooting phase, where you have 3 Skeleton Archers killing 3 Sylvan Archers with shooting. But the Sylvan Archers pass the panic test again, and that's again a good thing. No melee phase, because there was no combat, so we move to turn 3 from for the Sylvan Elves, and that means that we are at half of the game, because you play 4 turns in the pre-made lists games in the quick starter. So, turn 3 for the Sylvan Elves. What happens here? I charge the Wild Huntsmen into the archers, the Skeleton Archers with the Hierarch, because they're far away, they're 18 inches away, but their movement is high, and I have cast a spell that gives me extra speed on the charge. So instead of rolling 2 dice and adding that to my advance value, I roll 4 dice and I discard the lowest 2. So I'm maximizing my chances to get there. And so I declare that charge, only that charge, and I make it, as you can see from the star. And that means that in the charge phase, the Wild Huntsmen are in contact with the Skeleton Archers, all by themselves, exposed in the opponent's deployment zone on their own, especially because in the movement phase, I take the archers with the druids and I pull them back behind the hill, and then I go towards the edge of the forest with my dryads to, you know, avoid letting all of those units concentrate and all of the Necropolis guards and the Shaptis concentrate and attack the Wild Huntsmen in the next turns. Okay? So this is for the movement phase. And in the magic phase, I got 6 dice versus 5 of my opponent. But, you know, I never managed to cast anything. I mean, I did cast at one truth of time, and that was really important because that allowed me to land this discharge. Sorry, that's the last time I complain about dice. Don't blame the dice. Anyway, shooting phase, I mean, again, my archers are behind the hill. The general is behind the hill, as one song says. And there's going to be no shooting, but now there's going to be combat. And in when you have a round of combat, the first thing that you do is to check who's going to attack first, so you're going to compare the agility values. And so wild huntsmen go first, I mean, elves against skeletons, right? So the wild huntsmen attack, and I can put one attack on the hierarch, which is in the northernmost corner of this unit, and I inflict a wound on the hierarch. And then the four remaining huntsmen inflict 7 wounds on the archers. That's a lot. It's a lot of wounds. But, you know, it is shock cavalry getting into an underqualified regiment of archers. So it's what kind of supposed to happen if you let that unit in range for my charge. And if I'm really fast, and if I have the extra spell, and if I have a bit of luck, then it means that carnage can happen. Because when the archers, the skeleton archers, and the hierarch attack back, they inflict 0 wounds on the wild huntsman. And that means that the wild huntsman win the combat by 9. 8, so the 7 wounds done to the archers, the 1 wound done to the hierarch, plus they charged, so they have a plus 1 of bonus for the charge. And so, wild huntsmen win by 9. And this is interesting, because if you remember the undead rule, it means that when it says that when an undead unit loses combat, it suffers a wound for each point of the combat score by which it lost the combat. So if you lose the combat by 9, because 9 minus 0 is 9, it means that you get 9 more wounds. And then it means that the unit is pulverized and just disappears. So the wild huntsmen can rotate after they destroy their unit, and this is how the first half of turn 3 ends. Now, what do you expect to happen now then? Now that the general of the Undying Dynasties is dead. And this is really relevant, because if you still remember the undead rule, it means that it says that undead units cannot march unless they start their move within 12 inches from the general. And the general is dead. And so that means that in turn 3, the Undying Dynasties cannot march. Well, of course, they can still charge, right? So the Shaptis in the charge phase, they declare a charge against the wild huntsmen to punish them for the sin. But the wild huntsmen, as we said, their role is to charge and do damage. It's not to get charged by 3 large, heavily armed dudes like the Shaptis. So they declare a flee charge reaction. And so the Shaptis get the chance to redirect the charge, and they say that they also want to charge. They want to charge the dryads instead, and so want to do the necropolis guards. But the dryads realize that would be a very bad thing to do, so they flee. And what's left to do to do an Undying Dynasties unit is to just shamble forward. And in the process of doing so, the Shaptis also get a wound, because they are kind of stumbling into the forest, and that's a hindering terrain. And since they have quite a large base, I mean, see how big they are. It's 3 of them, and it's 15 Necropolis Guards, so they have a large base. And so these models with a large base, they have to do dangerous terrain tests when they charge or fail charge into a forest, right? So this was the charge phase. In the movement phase, nothing can happen because the two units have charged and have moved in the charge phase, so they're not going to move anymore. Magic phase, well, the hierarchy is dead. Shooting phase, well, the archers are dead. And melee phase, well, there's no combat. So sometimes turns are this short. But this is not an uneventful turn, because of the position that the two units of the Undead Dynasties are now. This is interesting. You probably understood where I'm going with this. But last turn of the Sylvan Elves before we get back to the Undying Dynasties. In the charge phase, I'm not going to charge, because my Wild Huntsmen to the north and my Dryads to the south are fleeing, and the archers are behind the hill and they don't see anything. So I can do rally tests to try and bring these two units to order, and I succeed in doing that, so they stop fleeing. And then in the magic phase, I don't really care about casting any spell. It's not important to me, because look at that. There is no shooting phase, there is no combat phase, and there's only one turn on the side of the Undying Dynasties to be played. And doesn't make any sense to charge, because the objective of the pre-made this type of games, I mean, you can use whichever objective, we suggest that you use this one, is to be within 6 inches from the center of the board. And the Undying Dynasties general is dead, because that's the only combat that the Sylvan Elves cared about doing, assassination of their general. And so what happens now is that in the movement phase, the Shaptis and the Necropolis Guard can advance, but they cannot march, and so they can only shuffle a bit forward without really truly doing what we need. No magic phase, no shooting phase, no combat phase, and that's how the game ends. So, wrapping up, what happened in the game? If this is the final situation of the battlefield, and the winner is the player who has the most units within 6 inches from the center, even if two-thirds in terms of models of units of the Undying Dynasties is still on the field, Sylvan Elves do manage to win, because of the avoiding the charges of the enemy and making it so that it's extra slow by taking advantage of the spells that you can cast and by taking advantage of the weaknesses of the opponent's army. So, all in all, this game, victory for the Sylvan Elves. But, you know, in my view, it's also a view for the a win for the quick starter, because I think that even with 3 units per army, this type of game is not just like, you know, push miniatures in the face of your opponent. Games can be very tactical, and in general, this can be a fun game, I think. Hope you like the report. See you next time with some other kind of video. Bye, guys. Ciao.